I want you to talk as well, perhaps also at a high level, about some more trends, specifically relating it to AI-based or deep learning, machine vision. Perhaps you can tell me a little bit more about the target markets you're seeing this, well, the uptake in target markets. What are you seeing in the market in terms of where this type of machine learning or deep learning is being applied, already applied, so it's been proven out. Who's actually really interested?
Good question. So I think it's in a lot of different applications within kind of the markets that we already traditionally serve. It could be, automotive applications, it could be semiconductor, it could be, as I mentioned, kind of the electronics applications. There's a lot of inspection type applications for cosmetic defects that deep learning can solve. So think of, body panels on a vehicle and whether it's scratches or cosmetics on a case of a cell phone or those type of applications. There's also classification applications. So what type of wheels are installed on a vehicle, for example, and if you have 100 different wheel sets, it can easily classify those much more through a deep learning classifier than through a traditional machine vision. And there are a lot of applications that we're seeing, like for example, with deep learning leveraging OCR, optical character recognition. So we're very trained from early on as humans to read text, right? And there can be all kinds of text that is written that we kind of easily interpret as readable, whereas traditional machine vision tools, OCR has been a very challenging, had to be very specific text and very specific lighting and application. And because, still throughout the world, systems are read by humans, we have a lot of text on parts and on product. So with deep learning based OCR, optical character recognition, we can have the machine or the camera systems read similar text that a human can read, and not have to, make specialized text or processing for that. And that's opened up quite a set of applications throughout many, many different industries. You think of date and lot codes on pharmaceuticals and cosmetics and those type of things. And so we've done applications where we're looking at those for returns processing and some of those things. We've looked at OCR or characters on a stamped assembly in automotive where they're embossed characters and they may not be highly legible with a standard machine vision system. We can use our deep learning OCR to read those really easily. So there's just a lot of applications that it opens up within kind of the same industries that we have today. But it really allows us to deploy and help our customers with the camera systems in ways that traditionally would have been more difficult to automate or to digitize.
And what can you tell me about integration with existing systems in manufacturing plants?
Yeah, so I think a lot of our customers have gone through some sort of digitization journey, and I think that's a lot of times the first step, right? Is like getting visibility of the process and where the bottlenecks are, and where the challenges are, where they need to either apply a lot of labor that is doing difficult and redundant, repeated tasks, and that's where machine vision can really help, right? And in both giving visibility to what's happening, like we talked about at the beginning, about not only where's the product, but what is its condition and whatnot, but also it can help with replacing some of those very repeated tasks for humans that just naturally humans get tired or whatever. So If we look at those areas where maybe a human is being used and rejecting parts, we would integrate a machine vision camera system and connect it to some sort of material handling system or some sort of reject methodology, or even, with augmenting the people that are there already to help them, do that task effectively. So it really depends on the application of the customer, but typically it's integrated in that way.
I want to go to the money question. It's a two-part question. So in a recent survey we did with our audiences, we asked them about the considerations, their considerations on or decision making when they are looking at new technologies. And I'll tell you, upward of 46% of respondents, and that was huge, from 46, and everything else we asked them about, other factors, ended up being 10%, 15%. But the one thing that they look at is cost, 46%. It's a determination whether they're going to consider a new technology or not within the next 3 to 5 years. So how would you say the economics of machine vision is changing? I said it was a two-pronged question. That's the first thing. And the other is, what's driving the ubiquity of machine vision?
The cost of a system is, of course, the product and technology that you deploy, but it's also the integration of that technology and the setup and the validation and the systems around it. A vision guided machine vision system is used in parallel with a robot or some other handling system, and a lot of times that system can be, a much higher cost. So it is all relative. But fundamentally, as we drive kind of ease of use and ease of deployment and making the user interfaces better to implement and easier to use, that helps with that cost of deployment. So that's a big area of focus for Zebra, where we've tried to make, very intuitive, very easy to integrate user interface and setup environment and validation methodology, so that you can ensure that when you deploy a system, it's actually doing what you want it to do. On the other end of the spectrum, kind of from a capabilities perspective, things historically that were very expensive. You can think of non-visible wavelength type cameras or high-end, very high-resolution cameras or even 3D imaging. The cost of those technologies continues to come down. So they become more and more feasible for certain applications. So it may be in the past that a 3D camera system was just simply way too expensive to even consider in an application to get a payback, whereas with time and with volume and with kind of the core chipsets and technologies underneath, those cost bases have continued to improve, and therefore it opens up kind of a nice return on investment for those technologies that historically would have been kind of relegated to the only the highest end or the science type applications, and can now kind of come to the factory and to the operation and provide a good return on investment.
Annie, you were just talking to me about the cost of an implementation, and cost is a very, very is really high on a list of factors that decision makers make when they decide whether or not they need to implement a new technology. But you had an interesting response to me, and I wanted to talk to you again about that. Tell me about cost factors.
So, I mean, basically, when you look at the product cost and the actual technology, a lot of times it can just be the tip of the iceberg, right? It could be that cost of product and cost of technology is a smaller portion than what is kind of sometimes not visible, which is the deployment cost, the validation cost, the integration cost, the maintenance cost over time of that system. So, I think it's really important that we kind of take a total cost of ownership type approach to any application and understand, okay, it may be just a few thousand dollars for the camera and the system and whatever, but it could be a whole order of magnitude for the total project, just based on the cost of programming and validating and integrating that system and making it actual work in the application. So helping our customers with that kind of total cost is a real focus for us as well. We always want to help, drive down and create higher value of the actual product cost, but looking at, those other parts of the deployment, there are ways to reduce the deployment time and improve our customers' ability to deploy the systems based on total cost as well.